Hi, I'm Christian, and today we're going to talk to you about the truth about supplements. Now, I have used a supplement before, but it's just part of my pre-workout ritual. It's some powdery, fruity drink. I don't really know why I use them or what they do, but Brooke is here to tell us.
And I'm Brooke, SOFLETE's lead registered dietitian nutritionist. Let's see whose feelings I can hurt on the internet today. I'm going to go ahead and cut to the chase. Supplements do not replace a healthy, well-balanced diet. They don't. It's in the word. They're meant to supplement your diet.
So supplements can't replace a healthy diet, but can they enhance your performance if used on top of a healthy diet that's designed for performance?
So a very small number of supplements have actually been researched. A lot of people are taking other people's research, and it has to do with specific ingredients, and then they're making their own claims. Supplements aren't actually regulated by the FDA in a traditional way. Supplement companies can make whatever marketing claims they want, and then someone has to come to them with a complaint and disprove it. And I can link up below where you can find information about how the FDA regulates this and some independent third-party testing.
So I've taken a scoop of pre-workout every day for the last 13 years or so. Is pre-workout really just flavored caffeine?
There's usually a lot of different things in pre-workout, the main thing being caffeine. And caffeine is pretty well researched. So caffeine basically can extend the performance for endurance athletes. Caffeine works best as a power booster for well-trained individuals, not for people who are just starting to work out, according to the research. So there can be some benefit to having caffeine for your workout. It depends on the type of workout.
Okay, so caffeine is good for a longer endurance workout, if that's what I'm planning on doing that day.
It is.
Okay.
The most effective dose of caffeine is 3 to 6 milligrams per kilogram of body weight. So a lot of the times people are actually having way too much caffeine, and there can be negative effects to that. If you have too much caffeine, it can be a diuretic, and we all know that dehydration is not great for athletic performance. So that's something to keep in mind and make sure you're drinking a lot of water. The other thing to keep in mind is that caffeine can inhibit the absorption of certain vitamins and minerals like thiamine, iron, calcium. So if you take a multivitamin supplement, make sure you're taking that separate from when you're taking caffeine.
Okay. So don't drink it with my coffee.
Right. So your multivitamin should actually be around lunch or later in the day.
So I start every workout with a ritual involving a pre-workout, and I usually end it with some kind of protein almost immediately after. What can you say about that? Is that worth doing?
Protein is a really great, cost-effective way to get high-quality protein that's usually low in fat, usually low in sugar, a lot of supplements. However, it's important to note that exercise is the initial stimulus. The claims that protein builds muscle, it doesn't translate like that.
Okay, so what you're saying is I really need animal flesh instead of powdered protein.
Food should always be first. Supplements are meant to supplement. The big thing with protein is usually it should be paired with carbs if you really want to increase that muscle building and have that initial stimulus post-exercise. The combination of carbs and protein triggers this insulin and growth hormone response. That's why they're best coupled together. This combination is really highly conducive to muscle growth. However, it doesn't directly translate into muscle growth. We're also talking about an athlete who's fueling for performance. This isn't for everyone. This isn't for the person trying to lose a ton of weight. I'm talking purely about performance.
So, Brooke, let's talk about creatine. Enough about protein.
So, creatine is actually one of the most researched supplements. So another thing about creatine is you can actually find it in food. You don't necessarily have to supplement it.
Red meat, right?
Yeah, it's in a lot of meats and fish and all that good stuff. But what happens is creatine increases the readily available creatine phosphate, and your cells can use it for energy. So that's kind of how it translates into enhanced performance.
Is that something that I'll notice when I am weightlifting or doing endurance sports or both?
The idea is that it's going to increase your power output, but there's benefit in a lot of different sports. There's actually over 4,000 studies done on creatine.
Wow.
And most of them, over 70%, are positive. Most studies with creatine actually show an increase in body mass. So usually people who are taking creatine, that's the goal. You're increasing your strength and power output, and then in turn, you're increasing body mass. So I thought that that was interesting that you see almost a kilogram or more increase in body mass as a result from taking creatine in most studies.
Now, is that just water?
No.
Okay.
A lot of people complain about holding on to water because most creatine comes in a monohydrate form. So some people might feel bloated in that way, but you don't have to take creatine monohydrate. There's other forms of creatine, and it's not just water.
Does the FDA regulate creatine?
So all supplements are technically regulated. but it's a backdoor. Supplement companies are the ones responsible for making their own marketing claims, and then people can file claims against them, and then they'll basically come in and say, hey, you can't say that, you can't do this, this claim isn't real, and they'll pull it. So you see that a lot in different pre-workouts that get pulled from the market. They put sketchy stuff in it, they get called out, it gets yanked off the market. So that's why it's important to do your research. And there's some really good websites for third-party testing, and I will link those up in the notes below, so that you can go on and you can check different ingredients, different supplements, and you can decide what is and isn't safe to take. And you should really care about that in certain sports if you're getting tested.
What about the flavor aid colored sports drinks that you can get at the gas station?
So people will drink a lot of those sports drinks, and it's not necessary unless you have some type of deficiency in the way you're utilizing minerals, or you're working out more than 3 hours. So if you're in the gym for 30 minutes, you don't need to be drinking a sugary electrolyte drink. It's just not necessary for that carbohydrate electrolyte solution.
It's just salt and sugar, right?
Yeah, there's other electrolytes, sodium being one of them, and a lot of sugar, which is another thing. When you are supplementing with carbohydrates for performance, you're going to have a lot of GI distress if that's all you're taking in. So you want to mix your modalities. So if you are an endurance athlete and you're someone who needs that, make sure you're having different types of carbohydrates, not just those simple sugars, but you want to be having things that are real food, complex carbs. So you see a lot of endurance runners have like peanut butter jelly sandwiches and things like that. That's why they're doing it. They're mixing the type of carbohydrates to get the best results.
Baby food.
Yeah, that's a gross one too.
So the ingredient in a lot of pre-workout that will make my face itch, that's the beta-alanine. And I see it in almost every pre-workout supplement that we have. Even SOFLETE uses it in theirs. What can you tell me about beta-alanine? What does it do?
People aren't going to like this answer. Beta-alanine, there is not enough research to say that it absolutely works. It's one of those where it may enhance athletic performance.
What is the claim?
Beta-alanine increases your muscle carnosine. Muscle carnosine is a protein-like compound. It's kind of buffering, acting as a buffering agent for lactic acid. So the claims that it can enhance performance has to do with that neuromuscular fatigue and delaying the effects that you're going to feel while working out. However, this is all a big potential. This is not solid, yes, it meets its claims.
So what makes it so hard to get a definitive answer on studies like this?
In all honesty, there's not a lot of research dollars that are being put towards enhancing performance. They're kind of focused on things like disease. When it comes to athletic performance, a lot of companies have to fund their own studies, and that's why they don't do it, among other reasons. They're just going to take smaller studies, or they're just going to simply make up claims. But beta-alanine has the potential to enhance performance when it comes to high-intensity exercise where you might get that lactic acid buildup. That's a tongue twister.
Good enough for me. So branched-chain amino acids is another one that I like to have on the shelf. I'll put it in my giant gallon jug and carry it around the gym with me. What do branched chains do, if anything?
So there's three amino acids. It's leucine, isoleucine, and valine. That's what the branched-chain amino acids are that people are using as a supplement. This is another one that may meet its claims. The jury is still out. The main claim with BCAAs, and there is emerging limited research, that it's going to enhance your performance for endurance events. This may or may not be true.
Now for the big one, testosterone enhancers, natural testosterone boosters, whatever it is that you can find on the shelf at your local vitamin supplement shop, or whatever comes up on your pop-up ads when you're searching for supplements online. What do you think of those?
Those are really sketchy, and most of them do not meet their claims. A lot of them have issues with cross-contamination and people getting popped on drug tests. Quite honestly, if you think that your testosterone is low, go to your doctor, get tested, and get prescribed testosterone.
So at the end of the day, it's really all about the nutrition foundation, the actual diet, your consistent food intake.
Absolutely. You need to be eating food for athletic performance. Your diet and the exercise is really going to be the main stimulus as far as increasing performance, muscle mass, or whatever your goals might be.
And the proven supplements, the ones that are actually known to make a difference are?
So caffeine, carbohydrate and protein drinks, protein supplements, creatine, also carbohydrate and electrolyte supplements.
And the supplements that the jury is still out on?
Beta-alanine and branched-chain amino acids.
And definitely stay away from
testosterone boosters and enhancers. So for further reading and scientific articles, you can check out the links below. I'm also going to link up the FDA regulation page if you're interested in learning more about the safety and evaluation and how that works with supplement companies, as well as those third-party testing labs if you would like to read more about that.
If you like the video and you'd like to see more, please click subscribe below.